1,200 miles off the coast of New England, is one of the richest fishing grounds on Earth. The Grand Banks.
Yeah, baby.
Home to brutal weather and unpredictable seas. This is where the perfect storm exploded. Over the years, thousands of lives have been lost here. Yet every fall, a few brave fishermen risk everything as they sail these deadly waters in search of giants. A week ago, the fall season began with nature's clock ticking.
2 months of fishing, you don't get it done, you don't pay the bills.
Line short.
For some boats, it was a dream start.
Slow! Well, Ugly, well! Yeah, baby!
We got him,
For others, disaster struck.
Shut it down!
Shut it down! Shut it down from down there! I can't shut it down from up here.
And already, the first storm of the season slammed the Grand Banks.
Going on the Grand Banks is going to hell.
Now, life is on the line as the search for swords continues. A 1,000 miles east of New England, the 75-foot Seahawk, captained by Linda Greenlaw, has arrived in the Grand Banks. She and the crew are eager to get the gear in the water.
I've spent the last few hours theming up into this place called Jukes Canyon. It's part of the Grand Banks.
After a shaky start, Linda is desperate to get her season underway and start making money.
I'm definitely excited to just get going and get some hooks in the water.
Yeah, we're going fishing. All right, on the back.
Linda's old friend and neighbor, Dave Hilt, swapped his lobster boat for the Seahawk to fulfill a lifelong dream.
I've never caught a swordfish, and I like catching fish. It's exciting. We're fishing.
The crew will set out a 30-mile mainline kept afloat by over 200 buoys. 60 feet below the surface, 900 baited hooks dangle where Linda's betting the swordfish will gather.
Stand by, stand by.
During set out, each crew member has a different job. Mike and Dave bait the hooks while Tim attaches the buoys.
Dave, you're a sword fisherman now.
It takes the crew 6 hours to get all the hooks out. By morning, they'll know whether they've hit the jackpot at Jukes Canyon.
Watch the backlash.
Get out of there. All right.
The guys have done a really good job getting the gear out.
We got through a set, didn't we?
It's fish on right now, right as we speak.
So I can't blame them for anything for the results tomorrow.
Big fish in the morning.
But we'll see what tomorrow brings.
Fifteen hundred miles southwest of the Grand Banks is the New Jersey town of Barnegat Light. It's 8 a.m. and the 70-foot Francis Anne is getting ready to depart under the command of Captain Chris Clem.
Pretty confident we'll do pretty good this trip. I hope fishing's good for us. I can't wait to get out there. I know that.
Deckhand Lemmy is the first to arrive for work. Just 19 years old, he's become his family's sole breadwinner after his dad passed away.
I'm helping my mom out, paying bills at home.
She told me the mortgage will be paid off by the time I turn 21. I mean, right now, it's good money. I make, you know, more money than any other 19-year-old kid I can think of.
Can't wait to get back out fishing. All right, I gotta go. Love you. See you in a couple weeks. All right.
I love you.
Joining the crew for the first time is Lemmy's high school buddy, Ben Ramo.
This is going on the boat.
Is it really going on the boat?
If we're docking, I'm surfing.
Ben's hoping that fishing will pay for his dream of becoming a pro surfer.
I'd rather do nothing for a living. I'd rather just surf all the time.
Is the blonde just got to move on?
Yeah. Why, you think he's hot?
No, he just looks like he should be surfing.
It was Lemmy's recommendation that got this greenhorn hired.
Ben is like my practical brother. I've known him forever. I've never actually been fishing with him, but he's one of my best friends.
I'm gonna try fishing out, hopefully that works, but if not, probably go back to college, maybe get a business degree, I don't know, I have no idea.
I highly doubt he gets to surf.
Time to go.
That's it, nothing fancy, short and sweet. No tears, just get it over and done with.
Got a pretty tight crew here, which should do just fine.
Ben is immediately put to the test by the veteran crew, who want to size up the greenhorn.
I've never even seen him work. I don't know if he's a hard worker or not, but better start to learn to become one, because our boat, we go at a pretty quick pace all the time.
How you feeling, Ben? Can you see legs? Walk around, just stay up.
The Francis Ann is headed 200 miles out into the dangerous North Atlantic. With large swells in the forecast, Ben must quickly get up to speed or find himself in deep water. 1,200 miles from New England, the 90-foot Eagle Eye 2 is getting ready for their third day of fishing of the fall season.
Just doing the last minute captain things before I get suited up and go join the fellas.
I think I got maybe 3 hours of sleep. Good little nap.
Got my cigarette, my coffee, and I'm all set. Ready to go, catch some fish.
So far, Captain Scotty Drabinowitz has been right on the money.
Now he's in the boat.
Catching close to $30,000 worth of fish in just 2 days.
Watch these boys pull in that nice 250-pounder.
Scotty is one of the most successful captains in the fleet and has a hard-earned reputation for putting fish on the deck.
Oh yeah, I can feel some weight here coming now. Hopefully it's a big one.
Two hooks in and already there's a bite.
Something on there.
It's heavy, it's pulling.
You got a swordfish.
All lit up, it's all lit up.
Woo! It's a big swordfish.
Oh yeah, nice fish.
They'll need all hands to get this beast on deck.
In the boat.
Watch your hand. In the boat.
Watch your hand, watch your hand. Watch your hand. I feel good.
What's today, saver, 200 pounder.
At the best market's price, that's $1,000 worth of fish.
Feels good, feels good.
Yeah, it's nice to see the first one break the ice here.
10 hooks later, and Scotty is living up to his reputation.
Another one.
With fish flying on the deck, Kenny must race to gut and clean them.
Not too serious, I hope. I better have a look at him.
But out here, Kenny knows you suck it up and keep fishing.
This is gonna be some sore in about 4 days.
As the set continues, the Eagle Eye 2 stays right on the fish. Scotty has laid out over $40,000 for bait, fuel, and supplies needed for the trip.
If this keeps up the way we're going,
we're probably going to have a banger trip, literally a real good trip.
By the end of the day, he's only 200 pounds away from covering all their expenses. One big fish and they could be in the black.
Oh, little baby swordfish.
It's a baby too small to keep.
Let him go probably in 4 years' time. He'd be 300 pounds. We'll get him. He'll be worth something.
He'll live to fight another day.
He'll live.
Miles from Newfoundland, the southern boat Big Eye has arrived on the Grand Banks under Captain Chris Chompers Hansen.
We cannot afford to make a trip that's not positive, and right now we're lining up that might happen, and I can't take that chance.
5 days ago, Chompers was fishing close to the New England coast and catching nothing. 400 grand in debt, Chompers made a desperate move. He steered his 55-foot boat toward the deadly waters of the Grand Banks.
Going up to the Grand Banks is a big gamble for a small boat at this time of year because it could get very bad, you know. It could get kind of dangerous with the weather, you know. The weather could change on us real quick.
Chompers has just a few weeks to find fish and get out before the weather is too much for his small boat to handle.
We need some warmer water to be gutted up to some cooler water, and that'll produce fish.
To catch swords on the Grand Banks, you have to fish the temperature break between the icy Labrador Current and the warm Gulf Stream. To find the right spot, he needs an up-to-date water chart, but his software doesn't cover the banks.
My first plan is to run out here to Billy and try to get water charts from him.
Despite his reputation, Chompers has friends in these waters.
At the Grand Banks, everybody works together a lot more. Everybody communicates on the radio every day. You'll know exactly what the other boat caught.
Nervous as hell every time I get around anything like this. If we collided right now, it would bust me open. It's like an egg. Glass and steel don't combine very good. Steel's gonna win every time. If we hit at any force at all, it would break us open and probably sink.
Print me a water pitcher.
Jack! What are you doing? This one.
We got it, Weeks.
It's just a piece of paper, but it holds the key to Chompers' success.
I rely on Billy a lot. He's a big help to me for information. He's got better equipment and a better boat, and he's been doing it longer, so I'm getting more than I'm giving.
Armed with the water chart, Chompers can start searching for a perfect spot to fish. 80 miles to the southwest, Captain Linda Greenlaw has steered the Seahawk back to the start of their main line.
I'm feeling really good once again, you know, thinking, okay, I'm doing what I enjoy. Sort of on the hunt right now, and we're here to put fish on the boat.
This is Linda's first set in 10 years. As captain, it's her responsibility to put the gear on the fish. Her crew has gambled that this legend still has what it takes to work the Grand Banks. But one by one, the hooks come up empty.
We can't catch them if they're not biting. Sometimes that happens.
We got something big here.
Finally, something is on the line.
Yeah.
A sword. It seems as if the Seahawk's luck has changed.
Ready.
Have a nice fish.
Yeah.
But two fish can't get the crew out of their funk.
Kicked already.
Look at this.
And conditions on deck have Mike unraveling.
Deck's terrible. Yes, it is.
Mike's having a hard time standing up on the deck when he's cleaning fish. The deck is pretty slick over there.
We can't afford to lose them, that's all.
Dorothy Hamill should be on this deck. It's the worst deck I've ever seen in my life.
Ah. 1,100 miles east of New England, the 75-foot Seahawk is in the middle of a haul.
Scratching my head.
So far, they've landed two swords. But even this small catch is giving the crew trouble.
God damn it! The boat, lower down.
Just
Just drop it.
I didn't want sword slime for breakfast, but I got some.
2 hours into the haul, and only 4 swords are in the hole.
Wishing we were catching a few more fish. Maybe we'll get them later in the year.
The entire crew is counting on Linda. And she knows it.
To have standards and know what you expect when you hop aboard a boat and know what you're used to having and know what the other boats have, and to have nothing, you feel crippled. It's frustrating as hell. These guys need paychecks. And they're counting on me to produce some fish. Having a hard time.
100 miles to the northeast, the Eagle Eye 2 is about to start their 4th haul back.
2 days in a row with 30 fish. We'll see how we do here today. Like to keep it up.
When he hooks in, and the line tightens.
Here we go.
It's a huge swordfish, at least 250 pounds. It's a 5-man job to get this brute on board.
1, 2, 3. Come on. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a monster fish.
Really helps out the day here. We just started. Nice little bonus here at the beginning, for sure and certain.
Yeah, that's what we want. Yeah.
If it's $4 a pound, that's a $1,000 bill sitting on the deck. Love to see them. I'd like to see about 10 more of them today.
In just 3 days, the Eagle Eye 2 has covered their expenses. Now they can start making money.
Now we're talking about fishing. That's what we're talking about. Nice marker, 150.
Scotty has found the fish, but can he keep them to himself? Just 5 miles away, Captain Chompers closes in. He knows the Eagle Eye 2's reputation and wants in on the action.
Hey, Eagle Eye, Big Eye, come in, Scott.
Yep.
So what do you think's gonna happen here? Should I stay in this area or do I need to go elsewhere?
It really doesn't make a difference to me. Whatever you prefer, come in.
Okay, I got you good. Well, we're gonna run up towards you. That was Scotty on the Eagle Eye 2. He seemed optimistic.
I don't know Chris very well at all, but a little bit of his reputation is he likes to cut in front of people. He likes to try to bully people out of their spot.
On his home fishing turf down south, Chompers is known for his aggressive tactics. But up here, he wants to play by the rules.
I told him I wouldn't, despite what he's heard about me. It's not true, and he was like, well, we'll see, time will tell.
He's a George's boat, he's not a boat out here, so I don't deal with him.
One thing he has to know for sure, that he's not pushing me around. That ain't gonna happen.
Down below, Scotty's crew keep pulling fish onto the deck. The waves on the Grand Banks have been known to reach over 80 feet, but they don't need to be that huge to be dangerous. A swell kicks up suddenly, and Kenny goes down hard.
You did what?
Oh, boy.
Kenny heads in to check the damage.
The back of my wrist, the blunt of the smack, I don't know if it's broken or not.
If it's broken, they'll have to steam to Newfoundland, a round trip that could cost over $70,000 in lost fishing days.
The guy is injured. We have to do what we gotta do.
It's all up in the air. We don't know yet. We'll find out when we're done.
It takes the rest of the crew 2 hours to haul the last of the gear. By sunset, Kenny's condition is worse. Scotty radios the Coast Guard doctor.
It's really, really swollen. It looks like it's starting to bruise up a little bit. Well, thank you very much, doctor. I described Kenny's symptoms, what had happened, what he's feeling, what it looks like. And it seems to be a fracture or a break.
Kenny's out of the game. And for a second time, Scotty is being forced back to shore.
So that's it. Trip's over, unfortunately, time being. Like I say, right now I got to get the boat going to get the man back in.
Okay.
All righty?
Gotcha.
All right, guys.
Miles off the coast of New England, the Francis Ann has arrived on the fishing grounds. $20,000 in debt for bait and fuel. The pressure is on Captain Chris Clem to get his gear in the water.
My strategy is try to get on the fish as soon as you can. Put some gear out that way and hopefully a couple of them will swim on by. I'm sure we'll do just fine.
As the Francis Ann prepares to set out, the weather kicks off.
Looks like it's gonna be a little wet back there tonight.
It's getting the out. It's supposed to be like 25 tonight.
Greenhorn Ben Ramo is in for a crash course in commercial fishing.
I'm nervous, so I don't know what I'm doing yet.
We're going fishing. I'll throw the first one. Just watch me when I do it.
Keepers in, we're rolling.
Ben's job is simple. Bring out the bait, throw the beepers, and keep a careful count on the number of dobbs or buoys which go out on the line.
We got about 250 floats, so we're doing four hooks per float, so that's 1,000 hooks. Bait the squid by putting the point of the hook up the high in the mantle, and then burying the whole thing, so that way it swims natural looking.
As the swells get bigger, it looks like Ben's first set will put him to the ultimate test.
But I guess if you're gonna break them in the right way, it might as well be a little bumpy the first night. Everywhere he walks, though, he's got his hands on the rail.
Sucks that his first night's a little but whatever, we'll pick it up.
The deck's kind of a mess right now, but it shouldn't really be like that.
Watch your foot, Ben, you're wrapped up, man. How you feeling, big guy? I think he's lying to me.
He's feeling better than he looks.
The rolling deck and hectic pace are proving to be more than Ben can handle.
Ben, you gotta work on getting some dobs set up. That way you can do both. The way I don't have to stop baiting hooks.
To make matters worse, the swell has hit 15 feet.
Hold on, I gotta go help. He can't get that.
And then a monster rears out of the darkness.
Slippery and the waves are just making you go all over the place, eating all over. It's all right though.
Yeah, I guess big waves on a surfboard and waves on a boat are two different things.
The final beeper buoy is tossed over, worn down and soaked to the bone, then survives 6 hours and 1,000 hooks of his first set out.
It was rough, but it's over. First set done. First night over.
300 miles off Newfoundland, Captain Chompers of the Big Eye has finally settled on where to fish his first set of the season.
I think it's a pretty good spot. I mean, I don't think it's the best spot, but it's the best I could come up with for what I had to deal with tonight.
It's time to go to work.
That's Grand Banks. That's why you come up here.
Glad to be getting my first set out.
Grand Banks boats usually have a sheltered area for the crew to set out from. Not the Big Eye. When the weather turns hard, there's nowhere to hide.
Back on the Grand Banks.
This is what it's all about.
Ooh, throw some water.
Got the pretty blue sea and the wind to come with it. It's like paradise.
Another place like it.
The conditions are treacherous, even for an experienced crew. Ooh. But despite the wind and waves, the Big Eye has completed their first set.
We'll have to turn around and run another 30 miles back up to where we started and then start hauling it in the morning.
250 miles northwest of the fishing grounds, the Eagle Eye 2 under Captain Scotty is slowly creeping its way into the port of Babel's, Newfoundland.
Right now it's real foggy, so I gotta pay attention here.
36 hours ago, deckhand Kenny slammed hard onto the deck. The fall may have broken his wrist and he needs medical attention. Once again, Scotty has been forced to make a costly detour.
Yeah, it's dungeon thick fog. Can't see 10 feet. Looking for the dock, looking for land. It's right over here, but you can't see him. That's wicked foggy. First time I've done this.
Finally, out of the mist, Scotty spots the lights on shore.
Pulling into the harbor of Babel's here right now. You see the dock. Finally, we're only about 30 feet from it.
After 7 nerve-wracking hours of driving blind, Scotty docks the Eagle Eye 2 and breathes a sigh of relief.
We managed to pull it off without a hitch. Maybe the big man upstairs smiling at me, but I'm real happy to have this boat at the dock and nothing crashed.
Kenny's injury means his season is over.
First time actually I couldn't work, missed any work on deck. Last year I got bit by a shark, but it didn't slow me down. I'll see a doctor, hopefully it won't take too long, but I think I'll be there a while.
All right, Scotty.
Get yourself fixed up.
Yeah, a little, yeah.
All right, Brian. I'll be back in the morning.
Black cloud really isn't on the Seahawk, it's on us.
600 miles southeast, the Seahawk is preparing to haul back their second set. After letting the line soak overnight, Linda is hoping to get this trip back on track. The mood on deck has improved, but the fishing hasn't. Finally, the first fish of the day.
Oh yeah, nice sword.
There he comes.
Oh!
Except I'm
nice mark.
With the first sword of the day on deck, it seems as if the Seahawk's luck has changed for the better.
If every fish we caught was that size, it'd be a perfect world.
Let him be.
Pissed, man.
Hit him, Dave.
Beautiful fish. Just right.
And as fast as it began, the run ends.
Yeah, busted off. Yeah.
I heard it snap.
Oh, yeah. That's a bad sign.
Miles east of New England, the 75-foot Seahawk is halfway into their second haul. Linda was finally on the fish, but then their line parted.
What happened?
The main line parted, I guess right below the hauling block. I didn't see what happened. Could have been just a weak point in the line.
Now they must make their way to the next buoy marker.
We should have a beeper on the end of this. 1803, which is a beeper that's not working.
To make matters worse, the weather has kicked up. Luck is on the crew's side as the buoy is quickly located. The line is repaired and the crew is back to fishing. But the rough weather is making the crew earn every fish on deck. By the time the sixth sword is on the line, the storm is beginning to bare its teeth. Finally, the last beeper buoy is hauled up. The Seahawks' first 24 hours of fishing have yielded just 14 swords and only one marker. For all her experience, Linda has been out of the game for 10 years, and it shows.
Ooh, a wicked long day. Two long days, but today was extremely long. Hard officer. Killing us. Man.
1,000 miles to the southwest, the Frances Ann is about to start their first haul back under Captain Chris Clem.
It's a lot nicer than it was last night.
Guys will get up, eat breakfast, grab a quick bite to eat, and then we'll start hauling and see what we got here today.
Last night, Greenhorn Ben struggled on his first set out.
Look out, Benny!
Whoa. Today, he needs to step it up.
Pull this in the box.
His most important job is to keep a close count on the number of dobbs or buoys coming in.
Lemon, give him a showdown on the dob, please.
Ben. Look, ready? Just like this. It's real easy. Pull it tight, set it up. Watch out. Whip the whole thing up. Get up as fast as you can, take it off. Start on one of the straps. That's it.
That's something coming here. Looks like a sword, I hope.
After 20 empty hooks, they have their first bite. It's a swordfish, or what's left of one.
That's not a good start. Shark ate the sword, ate it all up. That's not a good start.
But just one hook later, they're in luck.
Swordfish!
Fish on the deck makes for a happy captain.
We're locked and ready to roll.
Clem decides to have a little fun at the Greenhorn's expense.
Gotta look out for them rogue waves, Ben. Come on, fish.
The lines are heaving with fish, including a valuable surprise, a monster bluefin tuna that could be worth thousands.
Small bluefin tuna. Right in the eye, Benny Boyd.
We're gonna cast their pull out.
As the day goes on, the great fishing continues.
Yeah, that's what we like. Nice chubby pup there, nice one.
That's a good start.
Ben, now. Do it the right way like I showed you. Ben messed up the dog counter.
I'm very disappointed in you, you know who.
Ben's lost count on the dobs. Now Chris can't tell how far to the next beeper.
Simple math. Four straps, six dobs. 24 dobs. Six. One, two, three, four, five, six.
Right now, Ben is getting yelled at for up the count on the floats, which, you know, as long as the gear isn't broken off, it's not a big deal, but it potentially could be a big problem.
We've been saying the same thing over and over again. Six dobs to a bundle. Let's get it clear now. Not seven, not nine, not four. Six. A extra finger on your hand. Six dobs. Comprehend yet? Six. Well, you can't count the six, general math? Yeah, okay. Ben, do yourself a favor and shut the up, man. Six dobs, six.
He just made the mistake of talking back. He ain't been around long enough to do that.
Ben, let's get this clear. I'm not out here to make friends. I'm out here to make money. Just remember that.
So far, he hasn't gotten it right.
Six. Happy. Seven. Sad. Eight. Sad. Six. Happy.
1 week into the season, and the Eagle Eye 2 is on top with 20,000 pounds of fish. The Frances Ann is finally on the board with 6,300 pounds. The Seahawk is lagging at 1,600 pounds, while the Big Eye is dead last with 1,100 pounds. Bay Bulls Harbor, Newfoundland.
All
All right, get yourself fixed up.
With injured deckhand Kenny in the hospital, the Eagle Eye 2 crew uses this detour to unload their catch.
We're packing out. We gotta take the fish out, and that's about it. We gotta ship them back to the U.S.
Pack out the fish we have, and then hopefully we'll leave tomorrow morning.
Hopefully around 17,500 pounds.
Oh, 41. Wow, that's the biggest one I've seen this year.
Can be nice. Can be over 100 and something thousand dollars.
It's vital the fish are kept in the best condition to get the best price at market, which can range from $2 to $6 a pound.
It's a shame Kenny got hurt. We were really on our way to having a good trip.
Now they need to unload the monster bluefin tuna they caught 4 days ago.
Don't go anywhere.
Down in the hold, there's been an accident.
We pulled him out of the pen and his belly hit the metal wall.
Look at his belly.
Hold on.
Scotty catches a glimpse of the damage.
That's absolutely unacceptable.
And crewmates Brian and Etley immediately point the finger at each other.
Oh, it's not just me, dude. I'm pulling this. Why don't you just say, oh, say, I'm sorry. It happens. Well, you gotta point your finger at me. Oh, I didn't do it. It's him.
I don't know which one screwed up. Actually, Atlee's senior man, so he should know better. End of story. And belly got scratched up pretty bad. Could cost us. You want these fish as pretty as you can make them. That's the bottom line.
You got it? Looks good, 640.
111 inches. I'm happy now. You could get as much as $15, $20 a pound for that fish. So that fish right there has got the potential $10, $12,000 fish.
Yeah, bye-bye.
You're gonna catch your brother and sister and cousins this trip.
The offload took 6 hours and went better than expected. Nearly 20,000 pounds. With the tuna, this trip has netted the crew $100,000. The next morning, Kenny is back from the hospital. His wrist is broken in two places.
Can't go fishing again, man.
It's your right hand.
Yeah, I can't do nothing.
Your right hand.
Can't even make coffee, man.
Once again, it's a bummer, you know, that we had to leave the fishing grounds. We were doing really well. But this stuff really happens. I mean, people get hurt, break bones, die even out there, so.
Scotty isn't a man down for long. A few calls and he's found a willing replacement, veteran sword fisherman Tommy Fox.
Yeah, I got a phone call 2 nights ago. He said Eagle Eye 2 was on her way in. Scotty was the skipper, and I said, yes, sir, no problem. I'll go fishing with him any day. He knows how to catch fish, big fish. He's a good captain to get along with. He's a good crew aboard the boat. And I love sword fishing and tuna fishing. Love it dearly.
Now the Eagle Eye 2 can get back to the banks. 300 miles off Newfoundland, the Big Eye is about to start their first haul back on the Grand Banks. This trip is a huge risk for Captain Chompers Hansen. Everything he has is on the line.
It's very important for me to go out here and do well. I'm not gonna be able to pay my crew, I'm not gonna be able to pay my house payment, I'm not gonna be able to pay the boat insurance, and I'm gonna be done.
Hope we get 25 or 30 fish today.
15 hooks into the first section, and Chompers can feel some weight on the line. It's the best start Chompers could hope for.
Yep, swordfish. That's a swordfish.
Woody, get the live line out. Bring that fish up here. You know better than that. Don't you dare do that. Get your ass up here. 200
a 200-pound sword right off the bat.
Fish. Watch the bill.
Okay, cut it.
It's a good start, but then it's nothing but empty hook after empty hook.
He's getting ready to dive.
10 miles in, another sword, but it's hardly worth keeping.
How big's that fish, Weeks?
That's a grown-up.
small enough, I just seem not even have it.
That's a small catch.
This line is about as bad as fishing gets. Just tossbacks and empty hooks.
It's nothing.
Look for it to waste of our time.
We're at no fish.
And with each empty hook, Chomper's mood darkens. Any small mistake could set him off.
Look, you cannot wind these on here like. See how these are neat, Matt? You can't do that. So start putting them on here like this, and then when you're done, you can pull them all off and put them on there straight.
Let me tell you something. Out here, you can't afford to have an altercation and let it escalate. You just got to take it for what it is, take it with a grain of salt, keep your head down, and keep going.
Matt is winding the buoy drops on the buoy cart all wrong, putting them on there sloppy, so when they come off, they're going to be all tangled up. Greenhorn's got me pissed off right now, winding on there like it don't even matter.
The first haulback of the Big Eyes Grand Banks Gamble is a complete bust.
I'm trying to get my gear as quick as I can so I can get the hell out of the spot.
Unless he can get on the fish fast, Chompers will lose everything.
We went backwards by far today. We caught one money fish. Just got to try something else, try something different. We know where not to try now.
Some way, somehow.
It's original.